So how can we represent environments in Racket? And as we've talked in our last lesson, environments can be represented with hash tables, and hash tables have multiple names. They're known as dictionaries in Python, or hash maps in Java, and then you also have hash trees depending on the implementation. Whenever people talk about hash tables, they're actually thinking about a specific implementation. And in Racket, that's what they have. That's how they're represented. So that's what is available in the standard library, so that's what we're going to use. But conceptually, what we really care about is just any kind of, you know, key value data structure where the keys are unique. So this actually represents a partially injective function. As you know, hash tables were covered in CS 3.10. So let's see how they are represented in Racket. So in Racket, you can create them. We're just calling hash, and then you interleave key with value, key with value, and key with value. So let me give you an example. Actually, it's easier if I just create a terminal. And now, I'll make this a bit bigger. Okay. So if I do key one, I put one, and I do key two, and I put number two, that just creates a hash table with two pairs, key, where the key is called key one. And then, as you can see, it actually is represented as Racket pairs. At least this is the notation for Racket pairs. We don't really care how it's implemented on the back end. So we can assign this to a variable. So define my hash table ht. If I can print my hash table, I see that. So now I can query if is this a hash table. And if I pass that, I'll say yes. If I pass number 100, that's not a hash table, so it's going to be returning false. It's a bit confusing, the name hash, because you might be thinking of a function that generates a hash code, but this just means a hash table. So getting past that, you can actually compute how many elements are in the hash table. Just do hash count. And you pass the hash table there, and as you can see, you have two because we have one pair and the second pair. So what we're actually counting is the number of pairs that are there, not the actual number. You know, it's not four because there's key one, one, key one, and key two, and two. It's two entries, two pairs, where the first pair has key one and one, and the second pair has key two and two. Okay, so we can very easily compute hash table, the how many elements are there, and we can also query a hash table to see if there's a certain value bound to a certain key. So if I can do hash ref, and I pass my first element is the hash table, and then I pass the key, and I'm passing as key one, and that returns one as expected. If I do a typo, then the key doesn't exist. And what I note is that the runtime throws an error. So that's something you want. And actually, in your homework, that could be one possibility, is you don't, if you don't implement your interpreter correctly, you will get this kind of error commonly. And that just means that the variable is not defined in that hash tables where it should be defined. And the reason I say it should be is because the inputs should be correct programs that should run, and therefore you don't have to account for bad input. Okay, so now let's go back. If we do hash ref, we're getting the value associated with key two, which is number two. Okay, so if we print again, just to recall that we have two keys there. Another thing we can check is we can check if a hash table has a key. So we use the function has key, and of course it has key one. It also has key two. but it does not have key 3. So here there's no error if the key doesn't exist. So what happens if I do just hash without parentheses, without parameters? Well, that just creates an empty hash table. And what happens if I just pass three values instead of an even number? As you might imagine, that should give you an error. So it's saying that there is a key here, which is this number 10, that doesn't work because you have to do pairs. So you have to do, you have to have an even number of arguments in this function. Okay, so this is, that takes care of how you create a hash table by specifying all the elements. But in many cases, you already have an existing hash table, let's say HT, and you want to add an additional key there. So let's see what happens. So the way we do that is with the constructor hash set. So we do hash set, and what we set is the new key. So let's add a key 3, and that's that number 3 to it. Let's see what happens. Oh, we get a new hash table back. Okay, that makes sense. So now let's define hash table 2, which now has key 3 associated with it. So let's see the contents of hash table 2 again, just make sure everything is fine. And indeed, you can find key 3 there. Okay. So now the last thing we can do is what happens when there's a key collision. So what happens if I'm putting in a key that already exists in the hash table. Okay, so let's see what happens. We just do hash set, and we use hash table 2, and what we do, let's pass 2, key 2, let's pass number 99. And what we note is that no error happens, and indeed that this is a behavior that we want to happen, which is it returns a new hash table where key 2 was redefined to now be mapped to 99. Note that before you had this where the key 2 was assigned to 2, and now key 2 is assigned to 99. Do note that you have to, that the return, the hash table that contains 99 is the one that is returned by hash set. So you need to store it somewhere. So you need to have HT3. So HT2 remains unchanged, and HT3 has the effect of the change here. Okay, as you can see here. This is very important because, as you know, we are using no mutability. So whenever we want to change something, we need to create a new object or a new value. And that's exactly what's happening here when you call hash set, that creates a new hash table. So in the last, in this slide, I just have a few more examples that summarize what we've been looking at. First line, we are creating an empty hash table. We are in checking that indeed there's only there's zero elements in if you pass zero parameters. And you're also ensuring that the hash table is indeed a hash table. So therefore you have check true. And then we're creating a hash table H1 that has a new key foo assigned to 20. And then what I'm doing here is I'm checking that the value that is stored in H1 is exactly this hash. And please note that in all of my examples, I've been using a key to be a string, but it could be anything that you want. So I can create, instead of this string, I could create a string that is could have false. And now you can see there's a new pair here with key false, or it could be a symbol. Oops. And now, as you can see, foo is a symbol that is assigned to 99. Okay, so let's continue. Then you have some examples with hash set, where I first overwrite foo with 30, and I make sure that the H2, which is the new hash table that has foo assigned to 30, indeed contain is the same as this new hash table. And finally, we are testing if ref does what it's supposed to be doing. And in H2, we know that foo is assigned to 30, and we have this test to confirm that. And we also note the final test that because everything is does not introduce mutability, the old values remain unchanged even if you use results of H1 indirectly somewhere else. So the next bit that we want to focus on is wondering how we look at the notation, the mathematical notation, and how do we represent that as hash table expressions, right? So the simplest example is, how do we represent this symbol empty set? And as you know, the empty set represents an empty environment. So an empty environment is an environment without any variables defined. So as you might have imagined, the empty environment has to be represented with hash. So if I want to represent an empty environment, I want to write hash. And I know that a hash has, if I use hash count, I get zero elements. Okay, so now if I have a hash table, if I have an environment, this notation where I have e parentheses x, that's the same as looking up the value is bound to a variable x. Okay, so in this hash table e, the hash table is this, the key that I'm looking up is a variable x. Okay, so how do I do that? Well, I use hash ref. Okay, so now let's create a hash, an environment. Perhaps let's create an empty environment. So let's do define e0 to be the empty environment. So we're doing exactly what is in this line. Okay, so now what I want to do is I want to check, first I want to add the new one variable at least so that lookup will work, right? Otherwise it would fail. So now I want to do define e1 and I want to add hash set. I want to do it to e0. Now I want to create oh, actually this is going to crash because I have to load hw4util if I haven't. Okay, so this is a variable, and let's say I want to do a number 10. Okay, so it's saying that e variable is not defined, so I need to load hw4util. Oh, I'm in the wrong location. Okay, let me restart this. Work. Okay, now I do racket. Now I do require hw4util.racket. And now I'm going to define a hash table. Okay, so e1 is a hash table, sorry, an environment that has a variable x assigned to a number 10. So if I do e1, I will see exactly that. Okay, I see this. Okay, so now I want to look up a certain variable, variable x. So how do I do that? I do hash ref. So now I'm trying to represent this expression, e of x. So I would do e1. E variable x, and what I see is I obtain number 10 as expected. Okay, so whenever you see this in the slides, that means looking up in the hash table. Okay, so now what does this expression mean? Well, this expression, as you know, is updating an environment and adding a new pair. Well, we've learned how to do that. That's exactly doing hash set. Okay, so let's say I also want to add now a new variable. Let's call it variable y, and let's assign it number 10. So how would I do that? Well, I could represent this, let's say to e1. I would do hash set, and I would do e1. Okay, now I want to add a new variable, e variable. And I want to add variable y, e number 20. Now I want to define e2 to be this. Okay, so this represents this notation. Let me write. be something like e2 y little arrow 20. So if you see something like e2 y arrow 20, you would represent it with this notation. Okay. Of course, when you're implementing your interpreter, you don't have to write out e colon variable y, because you get that in indirectly. So you would just have some x as some e or some v. You would have some code more similar to what is here highlighted in the slides. Okay, so next we're going to talk about the test cases in a separate video. Thank you.